He did not die to expose that you're sinners. He died to remove sins, to expose that you're sons. Most of our lives we've heard he had to die on the cross because we're sinners. He had to die because we sinned, but he didn't die because we're sinners. He died because we're lost sons. Who's preaching that? Holy Spirit had to tell me that in a bedroom because I was so condemned and beat down and sin conscious. And I want to give my life to God, but I can't live for God. Right? Because I'll just mess up again. But all of a sudden, I see and realize, wait a minute. He didn't die because I'm an accident waiting to happen. He died because I was never created for sin. I wasn't born to be a sinner. I was born to be a son. So he had to die to get me back to sonship, to redeem me. All of a sudden, I realize nobody pays a high price for nothing. I'm somebody to God. Yay. And then we still let other things evaluate us and other things measure us. We still let past practice and people's impressions and what they say and don't say determine us. That precious young lady on the phone today, letting the world define her. What a tragedy. Under the pressure of the world to measure up, to fit in. Wanting a certain job to be a certain thing in people's eyes. Wanting a certain this to... Rat race. It's a rat race. This pastor in West Virginia made me really laugh. He said, "Do you know the bad thing about a rat race? You can win and you're still a rat." I thought, oh my gosh. Even if you win, even if you think you're winning and you're getting over on life, you're still a rat. I don't want to be in a race with rats. This is school, bud. I hope you come back, man. No, I'm kidding. It was just funny to me. I thought, you know, he's right. I want transformed. I don't want wrong motives. I don't want to reach the top. I don't want notoriety and popularity. And I don't need people to think I'm somebody. I am somebody to God. Christ died for me. And whether you see that or understand that or appreciate that or edify that or speak into that, what does that have anything to do with the truth that he died for me? Yay! I want to get so along with you. I want to be able to love you and be loved by you. But whether that happens or not, or whether you see, appreciate, or even want Jesus, how does that change that he loves me? Oh my goodness. There's no such thing as a bad day after that. When you get that revelation, you're sealed. It's over for you in a good way. Yeah. It just is. Because instead of being broken, you break. Instead of being hurt, you hurt. Do you get it? Instead of hurting because of people, you hurt for people. It changes everything. Because the first way, it's just all about you. And that is a lethal trap. But the conversion and transformation is it's all about him and others. And you get the great privilege of being like him by the Spirit of God. And you get to participate in love. Oh. And the only thing it'll cost you is what you gain through the fall. Self. Let him or her die already. And don't raise them from the dead. If you'd hear how many times I prayed that, I don't even pray it anymore. That guy's dead. But I used to just to be sure, right? You know how we are. No, it was a declaration to me because it just did something to me. I would say, Father, I thank you that old man is so dead. He is buried so deep, he can never rise again. You have made a brand new man. And then I'd leap and skip in my bedroom and just get really flighty and flaky. And I would say stuff like this: never again will I be ruled by anger. Stress has no place in me. Strife has nothing to do with who I am. Father, never again will I be bound by the dictates of flesh, because none of those things are what you made me to be. You made me to be like you. I was praying that stuff a month old in the Lord, like radically running around my bed, shouting and screaming, because I was so aware that I could change and I wanted change. Serious. My mother-in-law came over one day to drive